What's up YouTube and welcome to a new video. Now over the last few months I received quite many analysis requests for the Porsche Panamera. And among these requests were the one from Poolboy, Shiraz and Chris. And you know what I always say, once there are enough requests for a certain car, I will make a video about it. So, the Porsche Panamera. The depreciation curve for cars like these can fall in two categories. First, it's a Porsche. And generally speaking, this means that the depreciation pattern is relatively stable. The curve for a 911, for example, doesn't have such a large drop as some of its rivals. However, the Panamera is also a big luxury car, and it doesn't have the same recognition as the 911. And this means that, potentially, the depreciation curve can be very steep. In this video, we will find out in which category the Panamera falls, the one with the very steep depreciation curve or the one with the more flat depreciation curve. And as always, I will show you the depreciation curve for various models and market breakdowns. So let's get started. This graph over here displays the Panamera market, and we have the model year on the horizontal axis and the price on the vertical axis. Now let's cover some general market statistics. In total, there are 1,234 Panameras for sale, and as you can see, prices are all over the place. You can pick up a 2010 or 2011 model for $20,000 or a brand new 2020 model for $240,000. Now besides the difference between the model year and the mileage, prices can also be explained by the different engine types. So let's identify those. You can see that we have now the Turbo, the base model, the S and the GTS. Now each of these markets consists again out of multiple sub-markets, but I will come back to that later. Let's first have a look at this graph. Probably it doesn't come as a surprise that the base model is the most popular one. They do then also account for half of the market. This is followed by the S, the Turbo and the GTS. And the same ranking goes for the pricing. The base models have a median price point of $75,000, the S of $82,000, the Turbo of $99,000, and finally the GTS of $110,000. So now we know how the market looks like and what the different price levels are. And that means that it's time to draw the depreciation curves in here. And these curves show us that the base model loses $9,700 per year, the S $10,000 per year, the Turbo $13,000 per year and the GTS $16,000 per year. However, when you look at this graph, you can see that some things are a little bit strange. According to this plot, the Turbo loses 30% of its value in the first year. And this is of course rather high. Also, the GTS has the highest relative average depreciation rate. And this contrasts to the 911 market. There the GTS has one of the lowest relative rates. Now the reason for these peculiarities is that there are many things to consider when we analyze the Panamera market. To name a few, the car got a big refresh in 2016 and the cars from 2017 onwards are based on this refresh. And personally, I think that the cars after 2017 look way better than the ones before. And that might also be reflected in the prices. However, also the first generation, the 970, received a facelift in 2014, and also this might be reflected in the prices. Then there is of course still the difference between the two and four-wheel driven cars, the difference between some specific engine choices like the Turbo, Turbo S and the hybrid models, and the difference between the Sport Turismo, the sedan and the executive types. Are you still with me here? Now a natural consequence of all of these different splits is that you can analyze the market on many different levels, but also that this video would become very long. Therefore, I'm only going to show you the splits which revealed something interesting. We start with the base model and work our way up to the Turbo model. And all of the models we will analyze from a model year and mileage perspective. After these deep dives, we will then look at some aggregate numbers and do a comparison between the models. However, before we start with any of this, I would like to ask you to support this channel by smashing that like button. Now then, let's start with the deep dives and we start with the base model. If we look at that market, then we can clearly see that there's a market break between the 2017 and 2016 models. So let's split the curve by the generations. Now the first thing which you notice here is that the 971 model, so the most recent one, goes for a very large premium. The price gap between these 2 years is $21,000 or 31%. And this of course means that the market perceives the new generation as a large upgrade over the previous generation. And this contrasts the price difference between the 970 facelift and the pre-facelifted models. The price difference over there is only $1,400. Now when we look at the depreciation numbers, then we can see that this is of course the highest for the 971 generation. they lose on average $14,000 per year, or 13%. However, the curve flattens rather quickly. In the first year, they lose $16,000, or 15% of the average new price. Yet, in the third year of ownership, this dropped to $5,800, or 8%. And these numbers are a bit on the edge of what is usual for cars in this price range. The 970 loses on average $3,800, or 8% per year. And with that in mind, let's have a look at a different market split. The one between the hybrids and the ones with a traditional engine. Here you can namely see that the e-hybrids are considerably more expensive. They go for a premium of $25,000. Yet, this premium decreases when the car ages. Hence, the depreciation rate of the e-hybrid is slightly higher at $19,000 per year. Let's continue now by investigating this market from a mileage perspective, and we will only do this for the used cars. This will namely reveal some additional insights. Here we can see again very clearly the price gap between the 971 and the 970 model. Yet, we can also see that there is a gap between the 970 facelift and pre-facelifted cars. And this was not really visible in the previous graph. You can see now that for the same mileage, the facelifted cars go for a premium of a few thousand dollars. But again, this premium is not even close to the premium between the 971 and the 970 models. Now, when it comes to the depreciation per 1,000 miles driven, we can see that the 971 loses $578 and the 970 $294 per 1,000 miles driven. And relatively, this is around 1%, and this is a normal rate for cars in this price range. So that was the base market. We will continue now with the S, the GTS and the turbo market, and we will analyze them in the same way, but a little bit quicker. The graph over here displays the S market, and I immediately split the market by generation. And you will probably notice that the market looks very similar to the base one. Also here, we can see a clear price gap between the new and the old generation. However, the price gap is with $18,000, or 26%, slightly smaller than in the base market. If we look then at the rest of the market, then we can see that the price gap between the 970 facelift and pre-facelifted cars is not that big, or perhaps non-existing. Now, when it comes to the depreciation, then we can see that, of course, this is the highest for the newest cars, the 971s. They lose around $17,000, or 14% per year. And this is slightly more than the $14,000, or 13% of the base models. The older cars are, by the way, depreciating a lot less at $4,000, or 7% per year. And this again is very similar to the $4,000 and 8% of the base model. Hence, in absolute terms, the S loses more in the beginning of its lifetime than the base model. And this of course means that over time, the two values will get closer to each other. But more about that later in the video. If we switch then to the mileage view, then we can see again that this is very similar to the one of the base models. We can see again that the facelifted 970 goes for a premium, but that this is not as large as the premium between the 971 and the 970. Now, in terms of depreciation per 1,000 miles driven, the 971 has a slightly higher rate than the base, but the rates for the 970 are the same. So, all in all, I think that we can conclude that the base and the S market are very similar to each other, but not the same. And this goes especially for the most recent model years. It is then also so that the older the cars, the more similar the S and the base market are to each other in terms of price point and depreciation. And hence, the more value for money the S offers. And with that, we will move on to the more serious pieces of kit, the GTS and the Turbo. If we start with the GTS, then we can see that the market is a lot smaller than for the S and the base model. We can also see that the premium between the two generations is a lot larger at $75,000. Hence, the 971 is 2 times as expensive as the 970. The premium between the 970 facelift and pre-facelift is a lot smaller at $9,000. However, in terms of depreciation, the numbers don't surprise. The 971 loses the most at $17,000 per year, or 17%, and the 970 the least at $5,500 per year, or 9%. And if you kept track of the numbers, then you can see that especially the 971 is interesting. The relative rate is namely lower than that it is for the S model. If we transfer then to the mileage perspective, then we can also see a pattern which is similar to the rest of the market. And remember, this graph only contains the used cars. If we look then at the numbers, then we can see that the 970 only loses $337 per 1000 miles. And this is similar to the base and the S model. All right, let's move now on to the last market, the turbo market. You can see that the market is again split by generation, but that they also split it by the S and the base models. Now, if we look at the latest generation, then we can see that the S model is around $40,000 more expensive than the normal turbo. Yet, the depreciation pattern seems to be similar. In the first year, they both lose around $46,000. However, the average current depreciation rate is lower for the base model because the curve is slightly older. And this means that it's not really a fair comparison. For the base, the number sits at $27,000, while this is $40,000 for the S. For the 970, the number is a lot lower at $6,000 or 7%. And note that out of all of the models, this is the highest absolute number for this generation. Relatively, however, it is in line with the rest of the market. All right, we look now at a very detailed level to all of the different models, and I can imagine that you got a bit lost. I probably would have. So let's consolidate now a bit and put all of the markets in one graph so we can see the bigger market trends. But actually, it became a bit messy when I put everything in one graph, so I put them in four different graphs with the same price axis. That split you can see over here, and you can also see that we have the Turbo, the Base, the S, and the GTS. And with this graph, you can see the different depreciation rates and price points in a new perspective. First, you can see that the rate for the turbo is extremely high. New cars are a lot more expensive than for any of the other models, but after 10 years, residuals are not that far off from the rest. And to make this a bit more concrete, the price premium for a turbo compared to a base model is around $80,000 for model year 2020. 10 years later, this decreased to only $9,000. Now this pattern, where the premium of the more expensive model fades away over time, is very common. We've seen it, for example, also in the Jaguar F-Type market and in the 911 market. Therefore, the older the car, the more value for money you get with the top models. And this is something I definitely would consider if you are, for example, shopping for an S or a base model. For the oldest model years, the prices are incredibly close, and the S therefore offers a lot more value for money. Now, if we go back to the depreciation rates then this means, of course, that in absolute terms, the most expensive cars lose the most. In relative terms, however, the numbers are not so different. Now, we started the video with the question, does the Panamera benefit from a low depreciation rate, like for example the 911 has, or does it suffer from a very high depreciation rate, which is typical for big luxury cars? And if you are a regular viewer of the channel, then you know what we need to do to answer that question. We need to plot the Panamera's rate on the depreciation leaderboard. This leaderboard namely ranks most of the cars which I've analyzed on this channel based on the age of the car market and the relative average depreciation. Now, if I put that leaderboard on the graph, then you can indeed see that we have the age of the market on the horizontal axis and the depreciation on the vertical axis. I realize that there are way too many dots for you to make sense of it, so let's focus on the Panamera only and the trend line. Now, in this graph, I listed four different Panameras. The first two are the 971 base and the 971 turbo models. These are now 4 years old and have an average rate of 12.3 and 15% per year. And you can see that with these scores, they sit far below the trend line. They are even worse than the score for the AMG GTS, which has a rate of 10% per year. Now, the other two Panameras which I plotted here are the 970 base and turbo. Yet, also these score far below the trend line with 7 and 8% per year. As you can see, 5% is a much more reasonable rate for a car with this age. And with that, let's wrap up and conclude. So, we saw that the depreciation rate for the Panamera fluctuates quite a bit depending on the model type you're looking at. However, we also saw that compared to the other cars which I've analyzed, the rates are quite high, especially for the newer models. The drop in the first year of ownership is, for example, larger than that it is for a Porsche Cayenne. Yet, we also just saw on the leaderboard that also the older cars were quite a bit under the trend line and therefore have a relatively high depreciation rate. So, in the end, the conclusion is that the depreciation rate for a Panamera is quite high. The low rate of, for example, a 911 doesn't transfer to this model. And with that, we arrived at the end of the video. Now, if you enjoyed this video, please remember to support the channel by smashing that like button. Also, remember that you can comment down below with a car for which you would like to see an analysis. Once there are enough requests for a certain car, I will make a video about it. Don't forget to subscribe and click on the notification bell so you get actually notified when your requested analysis goes live. As always, a huge thank you for watching and I hope to see you next week for a new video.